The Bible says they shouted, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." There was joy in Jerusalem on that day. There's joy in this house this morning. Let's worship the Lord together.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging seas. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. My God still promises all the way. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
And we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Sing it again.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your
You can be seated.
As soon as I open my eyes, it's the same voice on the inside. Already so heavy, weighing on my soul. All the fear, all the worry, all the heartache, all the hurting, colliding with your lighting, trying to steal. Pulling me back, pulling me back, it's magnetic. I'm pushed to
keeps pulling me. Your love keeps pulling me.
Don't forget, the Family Scramble event is today right after second service. Join us for free food, egg hunts, games, and a bunch of family fun.
We hope that you will mark on your calendars April 15th at 7 p.m. and join us for our Good Friday worship experience. Come as we celebrate and worship our Savior by remembering His sacrifice.
The next senior adult lunch is 11:30 on April 21st. It will be potluck. Church will be providing meatloaf and fried chicken for me. So bring your favorite potluck and we'll see you then.
Connect College students, another hangout is coming at Joplin Avenue Coffee House April 14th from 6:30 to 8. There's going to be free snacks and coffee. We're going to have a worship time with Tyler Gibbs and a short message. This is open for all college students, so we hope to see you there.
Don't forget to get registered for summer camp. Visit firstjoplin.org/summer to register.
To find out more information on all that's going on at First Baptist Church, follow us on Facebook, download our app, or scan this QR code.
Hey, good morning, First Baptist. How are you? Wow, what a great way to start the service, right? When all those kids left, the average age of the worship center went back up. They brought it down quite a bit. Hey, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 21 and Luke chapter 19 this morning. If you want to go ahead and mark your Bibles or find that spot on your device, that's where we're going to be. We're going to spend most of our time in Matthew chapter 21, but we'll also be looking at Luke chapter 19 this morning as we talk about the entrance of the King. We ended our Zoom Out series, and now we're focusing this Sunday and Friday and Easter Sunday all on the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. Don't you love spring? Amen. The people that didn't say amen are those that have allergies. We do love spring. I'm just reminded this morning, you know, just seeing again the explosion of color that is spring reminds me that, man, that cold, hard winter gives way to new life in spring. Aren't you glad about that? What a reminder of God's cycle and His seasons of life and the refreshingness that He brings to our earth and also to our own life. So great to see every one of you. I've already got to meet several first-time guests with us this morning. We're glad that you would come and worship with us. We truly believe that you had to drive by a lot of good churches to get here, and we're honored that you would come and worship with us at First Baptist. Hope it's a blessed time for you this morning as we look at the entrance of the King. If you are one of our first-time guests, we would love for you to take a moment this morning. On the bulletin you should have received, there's a QR code. It'll also be up on the screen. You can take a picture of that with your camera, or you can just go to firstjoplin.org/new, and you can fill out our online connect card. We want to connect with you, but we want to be able to do it on your terms and in your time. So feel free to do that today. Feel free to do it tonight, through the week, whenever. We have a gift. If you haven't already received it, we'd love to give you. So if you are one of our first-time guests, man, on your way out this morning, just say, hey, I'm a first-timer. And we will heave a bag at you with some good stuff in it. I do want to warn you that there is chocolate in it, so don't leave that in your car. Also, right after service, man, we got hot dogs, we got hamburgers, we got a bunch of games, an adult Easter egg hunt, so it's going to be a whole lot of fun. So I hope you'll stick around for that. You'll see across the front here, we've got several of these offering plates. This is the time of the service that we also worship through our giving. You'll know that there's a black box back by those double doors as you go out. You can give in these plates during our song service if you would like. You can place your offerings or tithes in the black box as you leave. Or, of course, you can always give online or by mail. How you choose to give is not as important as the heart in which we give with. So pray that we would be mindful and that we would truly be a cheerful giver and one that gives out of an abundance of gratitude and thankfulness for the recognition that everything we have is from God. Let's pray together this morning as we continue our worship. Father, we are in awe of you. We're thankful. I just read just yesterday, God, that the river of God is full of water. Thank you, God, that you meet all of our needs. You supply everything, God, in our life. And for every born-again believer in here, we can claim that there has never been a time when you have not been enough. And we praise you for that. Father, I know there are a lot of different reasons why we come to church. But I pray, Father, that while we're here, your Spirit would remove any distraction, anything that would hinder us from being able to worship you, to hear from you, to meet with you this morning. Father, we thank you for your love. And we pray as we sing that they would be words not just on a screen, but they would be the overflow of a heart of gratitude. Father, if there are those, some here this morning, that have never trusted Christ, I pray that this entire morning would show them how much God loves them, died for them, and wants a relationship with them. We give you all of the praise and the glory this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's continue to worship him together, church.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to him belong, who holds our days within his hand. What comes apart from his command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand.
Joy when Christ is
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of life. And as you speak, a hundred million galaxies are born in the neighbor of your breath, the breath is born. If the stars are made to worship, so will I.
Yeah.
I can see your heart in everything you make. Every bird, star, signal, fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so will I. Jesus, you're the one who never leaves the one behind.
Amen. Hebrews 1:3
says he is the radiance of the glory of God, the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the whole universe by the word of his power. And after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. And he's the one we're here to worship. He's the one we're here to celebrate. The one we look to no matter what life throws at us. Let's worship him, church. Somebody this morning needs to hear these words singing.
Never stop.
Come on.
praised in this place this morning. God, we thank you for who you are. It's in your powerful name we pray. Amen. Amen. Church, you can be seated.
What a great morning of worship. Entrance of the King. You know, this week, as most of the time, even if I am in the middle of a series, usually for Palm Sunday, Good Friday, and Easter, I'll push aside whatever series I'm in and we'll focus like a laser beam on the entrance of Jesus, calling it Palm Sunday. We focus on his death, on what we believe Good Friday, and then we celebrate his resurrection as we have for 2,000 years on Easter Sunday and every other Sunday, to be quite honest with you. This morning we look at the entrance of the King, but I want you to think about this for a minute, is that when you consider that Jesus lived an earthly life of 33 years, and of those 33 years, three of those years was an active public ministry. And then you consider that out of all of the Bible, all 66 books of the Bible, and then you narrow it down into the New Testament, and then the four books that we call the Gospels, which are really biographies about Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Of those four books of the Bible, of those four accounts, they provide what we would think of almost as a lopsided. They give a lopsided amount of attention to the final 8 days of Jesus' life. Think about it for a minute. Matthew attributes almost 1/4 of his gospel to this final 8 days of Jesus' life. Mark gives 1/3 of his gospel to 8 days. Luke gives 1/5, and John gives almost 1/2 of his gospel to the final 8 days of Jesus' life. Of the 89 chapters that make up Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, 29.5 of them are attributing, recognizing what happened during this span of 8 days. From his entry into Jerusalem, the teachings while he was there, his suffering, his sacrifice, his atoning work on the cross, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And the reason I believe why 29.5, which by the way is exactly 1/3, the reason why 1/3 of these four different gospel writers focused on the final 8 days is because there is immense value in our understanding of the events that took place in those 8 days. Of immense value for us as believers. There is incredible value and worth for the church. And let me be honest with you, there is incredible and immeasurable value in those 8 days for the entire world. Those 8 days mattered. And friends, we're just dipping our toe in the beginning of those 8 days. The entrance of the King. These verses are going to cause some of us who have read the Bible for a while, it's going to cause some of us to kind of scratch our heads for a couple of reasons. One is not just the amount of ink, as I've already discussed regarding this event, that is found, by the way, in all four Gospels. The other thing that we're going to notice is that this is a story of King Jesus entering into Jerusalem for the last time. And he's coming into Jerusalem ultimately to pay the penalty for man's sins in a sacrifice. He is going to the place where he is going to die. And he's already told his disciples three times. Once in Matthew chapter 16, once in Matthew chapter 17, and again in Matthew chapter 19, he tells his disciples, I'm going into Jerusalem. Friends, this was not an accident. This was an event that was planned before the world was ever formed. Before God ever put into motion anything in creation, he already had this in play. He already had the plan in place to redeem man who had not even yet been lost nor even yet been created. This is incredible for us to consider. This was not a moment-by-moment changing of plans, no. This was designed and delivered perfectly according to God's infinite plan. What's going to seem weird to us this morning is this. Jesus is going to come into Jerusalem, and he is really, in essence, the master of ceremonies of this parade. He is the recognized special guest of this parade route that's coming down from the Mount of Olives into Jerusalem, to which the whole city is stirred by what they see. And what's weird to us is that we see Jesus, in a sense, accepting this parade. We see Jesus embracing this, which is odd for us because many of us have read in the scriptures where when they would see Jesus perform a miracle and they wanted to make him a king, he would withdraw from them. We would see many times that when he was being praised and recognized, he would kind of get out of the picture. We have read several times where he healed somebody and turned to them and said, "Tell no man the things that I've done." And yet now we see in this moment, in this last 8 days of his life, he's riding into Jerusalem, and he's saying, let it happen. In fact, he says, if they don't cry out, the rocks are going to break forth in singing. I love this story, and I hope as we read these two accounts in Matthew 21 and Luke 19, I pray that God does something in our heart. It says in verse 1 that when they drew near to Jerusalem, and came near to Bethphage, to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus sent two of his disciples, saying to them, go into the village in front of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, the Lord needs them, and he will send them at once. And this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden. And the disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them, and they brought the donkey and the colt, and they put on them their cloaks, and he sat on them. And most of the crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. And the crowds that went before him and those that followed him were shouting, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, and they said, who is this? And the crowd said, this is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth of Galilee. I ask you to join me in Luke chapter 19. I want to start in verse 36. That's a chance. I want to start in verse 36 of Luke 19. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road, and as he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, a whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, teacher, rebuke your disciples. And he answered, I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out. I know you hear this every year, but a friend of mine said about that verse, If that would have happened, it would have been the world's first rock concert. I have no idea how long I'm going to be here at this church, but you can expect that every Palm Sunday, that's coming. Every one of them. Try to picture this in your mind. Off outside of town, Mount Olives. If you were in Jerusalem looking out, you would have seen coming down this hill a huge group of people shouting, singing, celebrating. And they all would have been around. You would have seen them cutting down branches, and you would have seen them taking their coats off and throwing them down in front of this. And you would have seen them paying respect, adoring the man at the center of that parade, Jesus. And he's not coming into Jerusalem on a war horse. He's coming in on a donkey, on a baby donkey, no less. He is fulfilling Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Matthew makes that connection for us, so we didn't have to. What Matthew is saying is that Zechariah, 550 years ago from that time, 550 years before Jesus rode in, Zechariah prophesied that it was going to happen. To put this in context, 550 years ago was 1472. Christopher Columbus was a junior at college working at the campus library. Okay? I hope that puts that in perspective for you. I don't know that he was really a junior in college or a campus bookstore, okay? 1472 is 550 years from now. That much time had elapsed, not to mention the 400 silent years where nobody had heard a word from God. And yet here comes Jesus, perfectly, just exactly as Zechariah said he would. And the people recognize it. They know he's coming in, and don't get me wrong, they were looking forward to this moment. I want you to think about three different groups, because everywhere Jesus went, whatever Jesus did, there were always different responses to him. You see, sometimes he would perform a miracle, and he would be worshipped while others would vilify him. He would say something that would lift up some hearts and would oppress others. It would be full of anger is what I mean. There would be times when he would speak and the valleys would be lifted, and at the same time, the mountains would be brought low. There were always varied responses to Jesus then and Jesus now. And I want you to see, as this parade route is coming into Jerusalem and the king is truly coming in to Jerusalem, what are the different responses? And why should it matter for us? The first one is this. Number one, the followers of Jesus were rejoicing. The followers of Jesus are rejoicing. They're shouting, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. They're going back to their songbook, the book of Psalms, and they are shouting and they are praising because they are recognizing that Jesus, as the Messiah, is coming into Jerusalem. This was a moment they've waited for forever. They are excited to see what he is going to do when he comes in to Jerusalem. And I want you to think about this group because it tells us that there was a large group. We have every reason to believe that all 12 of the disciples, handpicked followers of Jesus, were there. But I can't help but think that there were more. You see, if you go back and you take Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and you take all four of those accounts, and you say what happened right before Jesus went into Jerusalem, you get some interesting accounts. In fact, in John chapter 11, right before Jesus goes into Jerusalem, he does something big. He raises his friend Lazarus from the dead. Remember, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. Jesus comes out to the mouth of the grave, seeing all the people weeping. Jesus wept, shortest verse of the Bible. And you remember Jesus told him to roll the stone away, and then he said, Lazarus, come forth in a loud voice, and that who was once corrupt came out brand new. That which was dead at the word of Jesus came out alive. Lazarus had been raised from the dead. And Lazarus then was seen in John's gospel as eating with Jesus. I can't help but think that Lazarus was there on this parade route. If you read Luke's account, before he comes into Jerusalem, he's going through Jericho. And there's a great crowd of people there as well. As he's passing through Jericho, there was one little bitty guy. Remember him, Zacchaeus? The wee little man? The wee little man was he? You know, the one that climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord to see? And the Lord said, you know what happened to Zacchaeus? A tax collector who had lied, who had swindled people, was apparently pretty good at it, encounters Jesus in his home and gets a brand new life. Zacchaeus comes face to face with the Savior of the world, and his life is different. He says, I'm going to pay back all the things that I stole fourfold. Zacchaeus repents, turns his life around, and gives his life to Christ. I can't help but think, in that procession, you've got Lazarus. Can you imagine those steps of Lazarus? Walking with everybody, knowing just a few days ago I was dead. Knowing that if it wasn't for this guy, I wouldn't be able to walk at all. And then to be Zacchaeus, to know that I once was a lying, swindling, money-loving, world-adultering guy, and now this guy has saved me, and he's not ashamed to be with me. Man. And then there's another instance of what Jesus did right before he went into Jerusalem. And as he comes out of Jericho that day, Mark and Matthew both record that there were two men blind sitting by the side of the highway. One of them, we know, his name was Bartimaeus. And as he sat there, Bartimaeus hears people walking by, wondering what's going on. They say it's Jesus of Nazareth. Bartimaeus knows that's a healer. No doubt, sitting on that road between Jericho and Jerusalem, he had heard stories of the healing and the power of Jesus. So he cries out, Son of David, have mercy on me. And the followers of Jesus tell him to be quiet, but he cries out even the more, Son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stops and commands him to come. And with Bartimaeus right in front of Jesus, Jesus says, what do you want me to do to you? And Bartimaeus says, that I might receive my sight. Jesus at that moment heals him. And Mark records that Bartimaeus then followed him in the way. Can you imagine those three guys? Lazarus, who was once dead. Zacchaeus, who was once lost. And Bartimaeus, that couldn't see. Can you imagine? Joining in that happy throng as they're going down the Mount of Olives, rejoicing. Church, let me tell you something. If you have been born again, you have been raised from the dead. You've been given new life. If any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. You are a new creature. You have been converted. Your life is not the same because of what Jesus did. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And you who were once blind, you now see things differently. Your eyes have been opened and illuminated, and the scales like Paul have fallen off, and you're able to see things for as they truly are. You see how upside down everything was before, but Jesus has now brought it into focus. Let me tell you something. As you and I are going through this world following Jesus, we should rejoice for that new life, right? We should rejoice and celebrate that we have been changed. Our life is no longer the same, and we should celebrate and adore him for the eyes that have been opened, not the least of which are a myriad of other things that we should fall on our faces to say, thank you, God. We should be like that happy throng, moving through, walking with him, celebrating, recognizing in our job, in our school, in our home, when we're at Walmart, when we're stuck in traffic, celebrating, not forgetting all that he has done. Let me tell you, I know I'm recognizing this group, but let me tell you one quick thing. Even though they knew who he was, they didn't understand what he was doing. They thought he was going in to bring about a political rebellion. They thought he was going to come in and kick out pagan Rome and take his seat. Make no mistake about it, he's going to do that. But that was not the time. The rebellion Jesus was making was not one that would be won with swords, but one that would be won with the word. It would not be a rebellion from the outside, but it would be a rebellion from the inside of a changed and renewed life, being born again, his followers, advancing his kingdom on earth. Sometimes I know who he is, but I struggle with what he's doing sometimes. I don't always understand that he doesn't work like I think he should. He's not working in the way that I would. And I wrestle with that sometimes. God, why are you not working when I want you to work? God, why are you not doing this the way I think you should do it? That's where the trouble comes. I know who he is, but I forget that I'm not always aware of what he's doing. Aren't you glad that even when I don't see it, he's working? I've sung 3 songs today from the pulpit. The followers rejoiced, as we should. Number 2, the crowd questioned. Who is this? I hadn't seen anything like that. Did you notice it says that Jerusalem was stirred? That word in the original language is the same word we get the word seismic from. They were shaken. They couldn't believe this. They didn't understand it. They couldn't wrap their mind around it. And here's the crazy thing. They were shaken not because this was miraculous. There wasn't anything miraculous about it. They just didn't know. They see all the people. They see all the celebration. They see all the rejoicing. And they're nervous. They're concerned. They're shaken. Maybe they thought this was a rebellion against Rome. Who knows? What this reminds me of is this. Even though Jesus had lived for 33 years and had a 3-year public active ministry, not everybody understood who he was. Not everybody knew who he was. You see, I told you those people before, they knew who he was, but they didn't know what he was doing. Just a few days after this, they're shouting, Hosanna. They're going to shout, crucify him. Crucify him. They're going to allow the mob to convince them to cry out for a criminal and have Jesus crucified. But this crowd said, who is this? This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee. Not the best answer. See, I told you the first group knew who Jesus was but didn't know what he was doing. The second group, they didn't know who he was and they didn't know what he was doing. And it caused them to be shaken. You and I are going to encounter people in our homes, at our jobs, at our schools, at Walmart, and stuck in traffic that have no idea who Jesus is. They may have heard us talk about him. They may have heard us celebrate him, but they don't know who he is. There's a whole world outside of these doors that don't know who he is or what he's done. And we, as his followers, have the privilege of telling them. Some of you may feel incredibly ill-equipped to tell somebody else about Jesus, but let me share this with you. Let me cut through the lies of the enemy for just one moment. People may want to argue with your theology, but there is no way they can argue with your personal saving testimony of what Jesus has done to you. The most powerful weapon you have is to say, this is what Jesus has done in my life. This is who I was before, and this is who I am now. They may try to argue theology. They may differ on their thoughts about things, but one thing they cannot truly argue about is your testimony of what Jesus did. So when you encounter those people who don't know, tell him what he's done. Tell them how he has brought you to new life. Tell them how he has forgiven you. Tell them how he has never left you or forsaken you. Tell them how he has swept across your heart with peace and abundant measure that you've never known before. Tell them how he's given your life purpose and meaning. Tell them how he has saved you from a devil's hell. There are any number of things that we can claim and lay at the feet of Jesus and say, this is what he's done. Go to those who don't know and share. The followers rejoice. The crowd questioned. Number three, the Pharisees were angry. Remember in Luke's account, they hear all the people praising him, and what do they say? Master, tell those people to be quiet. And Jesus says, I'm not going to. The Pharisees were a sect, a religious sect of the Jews. They were teachers of the law, practitioners of the law. Please hear me on this. Nobody in Jerusalem, nobody in that area should have known Jesus better and known what he was doing more than those guys. Nobody would have known the scriptures. Outside of Jesus, nobody would have known the scriptures better than those guys. Please listen. When they looked up out of Jerusalem and saw the parade and saw Jesus sitting on the colt of a donkey, they should have said, that's him. Oh my God, that's Zechariah 9:9. They should have said, we were wrong. We didn't believe that all these miracles were done by the power of God, and we didn't believe his teachings, and we didn't believe what he was teaching us. We didn't see it, but now I see it. They should have seen Zechariah 9:9. They should have seen all the scriptures so clearly. But they missed it. They missed it. Nobody knew it better and missed it further than them. I am thankful. I don't want this to sound be taken the wrong way. But I am thankful that there were guys in the scripture that are given to me as a cautionary tale. Because this morning I can tell you this. It does not matter how much you know up here. If it don't get down here, it doesn't. You can know all of the verses. You can remember every single flannel graph, every coloring page. You can remember your mom and your dad kneeling at your bedside praying. You can remember family devotions with your grandparents. You can remember every single memory verse and Bible club lesson. But if it doesn't move from here, down to here, you don't get saved up here. You get saved here. They knew. They missed it. What a reminder. There was a man of the Pharisees remember, they would have known. It says in John chapter 3, it'll be up on the screen. It says, now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. And this man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher that has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. And Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Profound. Doesn't matter what you know, it doesn't matter what you've done, unless a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, how can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Ew. Yeah. Flannel graph that. Nicodemus was still thinking physically. Nicodemus was still thinking with his head. And Jesus said, truly I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. Jesus is saying it is not physical. Now don't get me wrong. If you have those memories of your mother and your father praying at your bedside, if you have those sweet memories of family devotions and lessons as a kid in the flannel graph, and you've got it up here, great. That's awesome. But would you this morning be so bold as to say, God, do I only have it up here? Do I only know these verses? Or have I taken what I've known about who you are? And what you've done, that this king entered into Jerusalem to die to pay the sins of my life, to pay the penalty that I owed a holy God. That's what Jesus did. That's not just up here, that's here. God, I am a sinner. I have sinned in acts of commission and in acts of omission. I have sinned against you in what I have done and what I have not done. I have sinned with my hands, my mind, my mouth, my feet. God, I'm a sinner. And could you today, from your heart to God, say, I believe with my whole heart that Jesus died on the cross for my sins and was raised again the third day. And today, this day, on the entrance of the King, I turn from my old life and I receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. From the head to the heart. Some of you may not have ever had your family pray at your bedside. You never had the flannel graph. You never had someone pour into you. You never had those lessons. Here's the good news. Even if you didn't have that, today you can still receive Christ as your Savior. That little seed, that little nugget, that one little piece of truth that you've just heard about what the gospel is and what Jesus did for you, that one little seed you heard today when planted in the heart through faith, will grow in salvation. I want to ask you today, right now, of those three groups, which one represents you? Are you a follower who knows what he's done, knows who he is, still struggles sometimes with what he's doing? Or are you one who doesn't know him? Or are you one that should know him? This is our response time, and I'm going to have counselors that are going to be ready to receive you. You come, you don't have to speak the language. You just walk down this aisle and you say, listen, I want to talk to somebody about Jesus. Our counselors are going to be able to lead you to the decision that God, to help you understand the decision that God is calling you to. Guys, early service, we had an 82-year-old man come forward and say, I need to be baptized. God is working in this place, and if you've never trusted Christ, I'm going to invite you to come. If you've got a decision, I'm going to invite you to come. When I say amen, Father, this morning, we are thankful that you are the King who walked into Jerusalem. You are the King that stood before the crowd. You were the king that climbed on the cross. You were the king that came busting out of the tomb to show us that you are who you said you were. You are the king that has come into this place today, and you are the king that longs to rule supreme in our lives. So break down the walls of our heart and lay claim to your throne today. For those that have never started that relationship, I pray that this moment would be the day they take that step towards you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks for joining us for service this morning. If you made any decisions or would like to talk to someone, please contact the church office. We look forward to meeting you in person.